So if you are taking a Calculus 2 class right now, then most likely you're doing a lot of integrals. And I'm pretty sure many of you guys have the following question. That is, why are integrals so hard? Especially if you compare integrals with derivative. That's why I wanted to give you guys some of my reasons on why integrals are so hard. And of course, I'll also show you guys how we can be better prepared for integrals. Here we go. First, the truth is when we do integrals, we need a lot of things that we have done in the past. We definitely have to maintain a lot of the previous knowledge. For example, when we're trying to do an indefinite integral, we are just trying to find an antiderivative of the function. And how do we find an antiderivative? Well, we better know the derivative first. Therefore, we have to remember all the derivatives that we did in Calc 1. Make sure you guys have something like this, a derivative table. Better yet, a blank one so you can test yourself to see if you have remembered them or not. Next, when we do integrals, of course, there are so many steps. In particular, the algebraic steps. Factoring, completing a square, partial fraction, decomposition, etc. Of course, next, how can we forget about our trig? All these identities are crucial for doing integrals. In particular though, we need to know how to go from one trig expression into what I call the integral ready form in order to be integrated. Go ahead and check out this file on my Patreon if you would like. And of course, we have more. Now, these right here are just some of the previous knowledge, but once we get to Calc 2, of course, we have the new knowledge. And when we do integrals, there are so many different techniques. Well, recall from Calc 1, we start with the reverse power rule. And then we have the U sub. And once we get to Calc 2, we begin with integration by parts. And then you also see some trig substitution. And depending on your instructor, some of them might cover what we call the firestrap substitution, some of them not. Notice I didn't put down partial fractions or trig integrals because they are more toward like the algebra or the trig identity part. For integration by partial fractions and also trig integrals, you really need to know the integral ready forms that I have right here for you guys. And sometimes you also have to use properties in order to figure out some integrals. So there are just so many different techniques. Okay, besides having so many different techniques, guess what? We actually also have different types of integrals as well. First, we have the integral of f of x. That's just the indefinite integral. You just pretty much have to do the antiderivative for that. And then we have the definite integral where we have a and b right here. And this is harder because at the end you still have to plug in the numbers and sometimes we may make some like arithmetic mistakes. And for this, sometimes you may have to use properties in order to figure it out, such as if f is an even or an odd function. And sometimes this is also going to be pretty tricky because f might not be continuous. So this right here, you might have seen in Calc 1, and once you get to Calc 2, we have the improper integrals. Instead of going from a to b, we have a to infinity maybe. This right here, we are integrating the function over an infinite interval. And sometimes you may have the negative infinity down here, depends. This right here is type 1 of the improper integral. There's also the type 2 improper integral, where you have a vertical asymptote on the interval that you're trying to integrate. Now notice, because we're dealing with infinity, and sometimes when you have vertical asymptote, that's also a kind of infinity. Well, when we're dealing with infinities, we better remember our limits. So let me put that right here. Limits from the previous class. Now, you know what's better than one integral? The answer is two integrals. We may also have two integrals. But in fact, this is going to be in Calc 3. Just a small introduction. Let's say we have an integral from a to b, c to d. Inside here though, it's not just f of x. But in fact, we have another variable, y. Outside here, not only we have dx, but we also have dy. Sometimes we may have to change the order of dx and dy Sometimes these right here might be functions. Yeah, so it's going to be pretty complicated once we get to calc 3. And can we have one more? Sure, that's a triple integral, but we can talk about that later. So as you can see, with these three reasons, I think that makes integrals hard enough already, but in fact, I have two more for you guys. For number four, I think this is the worst one. That is, sometimes if you make a small change to an innocent looking. For number four, I think this is the worst one. That is, sometimes when we make a small change to an innocent integral, the whole thing becomes so much different. Have a look. I'm going to call this small change, but big difference. And I'm going to give you guys a classic example. Can you guys go ahead and integrate 1 over x to the fifth power for me real quick? Sure thing, right? This is the same as x to the negative 5. Add 1 to the power, we get negative 4. Divided by that, so we get negative 1 over 4. X to the negative 4, can put that down on the bottom, and that's the answer. Done deal. Now, I'm pretty sure you guys know what I'm going to do too. Can you guys go ahead and integrate 1 over x to the 5th power? I'm going to make a small change here. I'm going to put down plus 2. I didn't put down plus 1 because I knew what you guys were asking me to do, right? That's why I put down plus 2 instead of plus 1. Can you guys go ahead and integrate this real quick? The answer is not ln of x to the 5th power plus 2 though. You want to see the answer? It's right here. Look, it's like that. The only thing I did was I changed the bottom to a plus 2 right here, right? Yeah, and then the answer becomes so much more different. This is what I mean by a small change, big difference. And this is dangerous when we do integrals. Imagine your teacher show you guys this in class as an example, and then put this on the test. It's not going to be funny at all. Okay, number 5. This right here is the one that's going to make us sad, because sometimes when you are trying so hard to solve an integral, the integral might not even have an answer in the first place. So I'll just say, number 5, no answer? Yes, it's possible to have an integral without any answers. For example, if you look at the integral of e to the x, that's super easy, it's just e to the x plus e. But if I change this to e to the x squared, this integral has no answer. In fact, it has no elementary answer, but I'm going to explain that later. Here's another example, sine of x. Well, that would be easy, but if I put sine of x, then this integral has no answer. It's true. Now you may wonder, we can totally differentiate sine of x by using the chain rule. Yes, we can also differentiate e to the x squared by using the chain rule. But if we are trying to integrate this and that, they don't even have answers in the first place. Yeah. In fact, there are also different levels of no answer. Let me explain this now. For this one, if you want to be more sophisticated, you can say it has no elementary answer. What I mean by that is, you cannot think about regular functions I put together and then differentiate that and you end up with e to the x squared. It's not possible. And it's very hard to prove that that's not possible, by the way. But now, if you're in your Calc 2 class, it's totally okay to say this right here has no answer, or a more sophisticated way to say is it has no elementary answer. Later on, once you get to a higher level math class, you can actually see a definition for the answer for this right here, and that's called the imaginary error function. And that will be the advanced answer for that. In fact, this idea is not the first time we're encountering, because we also have this right here from our algebra class. How would you solve x squared is equal to negative 1? Well, it depends. It depends on what though? It depends on what class you're in. Because for example, if you're in a pre-algebra class, what do you say about this? Well, you are going to say this right here has no answer, right? Because it's not possible to square a number end up with negative 1. As some of your teacher might told you, you should really put down no Real answer. What does this even mean? You will have to wait until Algebra 2 or Precalculus, because these are the usual classes that we started to learn about complex numbers. And that's like the definition of the solution to this impossible equation previously. And the answers for that is x is equal to plus or minus I, where I is the imaginary number. So, same idea here. Now, how about for this one though? Do I really just say that has no elementary answer either? No. This right here, in fact, it has absolutely no answer. Well, just in case that you are saying that oh, we do have an answer for this. Well, hold on. I'm going to put a square root right here. And I'm going to put a pi right here. And now what? Anyways, these are my five reasons on what makes integrals so hard. What do you guys think? Now, of course, as I mentioned it, how are we going to be better prepared for integrals? Watching videos, reading books, reading notes, of course they work and they are really important, but the most important thing is that you have to ask yourself, can you do the questions on your own? And that's why I have all these quizzes on my Patreon. You guys can go ahead and download it and try it out. Make sure you know how to solve them on your own. These are the quiz questions that I gave to my students previously. Quiz exams right here, you guys can go try them out. The links will be in the description. If you have any questions, feel free to let me know in the comments. That's it.